This presentation is on endometrial cancer. The following outlines the contents of the presentation: epidemiology, risk factors and pathogenesis, clinical presentation and investigations, staging of disease, management, and prognosis and follow-up. Endometrial cancer is the most common gynecological cancer and the fourth most common cancer among women in Singapore. As endometrial cancer is usually localized within the uterus upon diagnosis, with 75% of women presenting with early disease, it allows for more effective treatment for the cancer. Together with the greater use of chemotherapy for gross residual or metastatic endometrial cancer since the 1990s, as well as improved radiotherapeutic approaches, there has been a good survival outcome among endometrial cancer patients. The incidence of endometrial cancer is fourfold higher in developed countries and also increases between the ages of 40 to 55, thereafter reaching a plateau. Women with relatively high levels of circulating estrogens or prolonged estrogen influence are at increased risk of developing endometrial cancer due to a direct mitogenic effect on endometrial cells. There is a substantial risk from unopposed estrogen replacement therapy and should only be used for hysterectomized women. Women on tamoxifen are also at increased risk of endometrial cancer, with a fourfold increase after 5 years of usage. There is a sixfold increase in risk in women with BMI more than 40, likely due to peripheral conversion of androgens in adipose tissue to estrogens. Other risk factors include nulliparity, infertility or failure to ovulate, diabetes, and hypertension. Families affected with hereditary non-polyposis colorectal cancer syndrome has a 40% lifetime risk of developing endometrial cancer. There has been increasing consensus that endometrial cancers can be divided into two types based on clinical and molecular characteristics. 80% belongs to type 1 cancer, usually occurring in pre- and perimenopausal women with hyperestrogenism resulting in endometrial hyperplasia. These tumors are usually low-grade, of endometrioid type, and are of good prognosis. 20% belongs to type 2 cancers, usually occurring in postmenopausal women with hypoestrogenism. These cancers are usually high-grade, of clear cell or serous types, and carry poor prognosis. They are characterized by early metastasis, resistance to therapy, and high mortality rates. Endometrial cancer is usually seen grossly as a raised, irregular, sometimes papillary area arising from the surface of the endometrium. It often arises in the fundal region and the internal os is rarely involved early in the disease. Its depth of invasion into the underlying myometrium is a significant predictor of nodal metastasis. With regards to the histopathology, majority belong to the conventional endometrioid adenocarcinoma type, which can be further graded into well, moderately, and poorly differentiated types. Other less common histological subtypes include serous, adenosquamous, clear cell, and undifferentiated carcinomas. Most women with endometrial cancer present in postmenopausal years with postmenopausal bleeding being the initial clinical symptom. Up to 10% of women with postmenopausal bleed are subsequently diagnosed with endometrial cancer. Premenopausal women usually present with irregular bleeding, but over one-third complain of heavy but regular periods. Women may also present with a foul-smelling postmenopausal discharge due to a pyometria, and it is usually in these women that the rare pure squamous carcinoma is found. The presence of pelvic pain usually indicates metastatic disease due to nerve compression on the pelvic side wall. Physical examination is usually unremarkable, but several signs should be looked out for in women with postmenopausal bleed, such as bulky uterus, cervical or vaginal involvement, or enlarged lymph nodes. Patients with suspicious symptoms should initially be investigated with transvaginal ultrasound to assess the endometrium and to identify those at higher risk of endometrial cancer. Transvaginal ultrasound measurement of 5 mm can be a good diagnostic index with 96% sensitivity and 61% specificity. Hence, a thin endometrial measurement can exclude endometrial disease in majority of postmenopausal women with vaginal bleeding. A definitive diagnosis is made by histology, either by endometrial sampling or dilatation and curettage. Currently, routine screening of asymptomatic women for endometrial cancer is not justified, Current evidence also does not justify any form of the above investigations in postmenopausal women on tamoxifen in the absence of abnormal vaginal bleeding. Further imaging such as chest X-ray, CT scan, or MRI pelvis may be indicated in the preoperative evaluation of endometrial cancer. This is a table showing the FIGO 2010 surgical staging of endometrial cancer, with stage 1 disease confined to the uterus. Endometrial carcinoma spreads by invading the myometrium, and the more or deeply it invades, the greater the likelihood of lymphatic or less commonly systemic involvement. Spread to the cervix may occur by extension along the surface, which does not affect the prognosis, unlike infiltration of the cervical stroma, which places the disease at stage 2. Stage 3 disease involves local original spread of the tumor. In women with metastatic disease, as in stage 4, spread to the peritoneal organs may occur. Transperitoneal spread occurs either when myometrial invasion reaches the serosal surface or via the fallopian tubes, then involving the peritoneal surfaces and omentum. The VIGO staging is important in determining prognosis and treatment post-hysterectomy. In the management of endometrial cancer, total hysterectomy and bilateral salpingo-oophorectomy with peritoneal washings is the mainstay of treatment. Once the abdominal cavity is entered, washing should be taken from around the uterus, bladder, and pouch of Douglas, with attention being paid to the liver, omentum, uterine annexal, and retroperitoneal node-bearing areas. Approaches for THBSO include abdominal, laparoscopic, or vaginal. Laparoscopic surgery for primary management of endometrial cancer has been successfully reported, with a large randomized trial establishing the efficacy of laparoscopic surgical staging, and it also resulted in fewer complications and shorter hospital stays as compared to conventional laparotomy. However, survival results are currently still pending. Studies have shown that there is no evidence of benefit in terms of overall or recurrence-free survival for pelvic lymphadenectomy in women with early endometrial cancer, and that combined para-aortic and pelvic lymphadenectomy should only be done in women with endometrial cancer that express high-risk features such as high-grade cell types including grade 3 cancer, serous, clear cell, undifferentiated cancer, cervical involvement, deep myometrial invasion, or intraoperative nodal involvement. The most important role of radiotherapy is as adjuvant therapy following surgery in early stage disease with intermediate to high risk features as well as in advanced stage disease. It is employed as the primary modality for patients unfit for surgery and for advanced stage cancer when surgery is inappropriate. It also provides good palliation in advanced stage disease for symptom relief such as control of vaginal bleeding or localized bone metastasis. Paclitaxel and carboplatin are chemotherapeutic agents with good activity against endometrial cancer. The indications for adjuvant chemotherapy include intermediate to high-risk early-stage disease as well as advanced disease. Palliative chemotherapy is often offered to stage 4 diseases and relapsed cases. Hormonal therapy in terms of high-dose progesterone therapy can be used in advanced-stage disease in patients where radiotherapy or surgery are not appropriate. Progestogens commonly used include megestrol estate and medroxyprogesterone. However, studies have not shown a reduction in death rates for endometrial cancer with progesterone therapy. For patients diagnosed with endometrial cancer at age less than 40 years and who desire fertility, primary treatment with high-dose progesterone is feasible followed by assisted reproduction. However, very strict selection criteria applies and close follow-up is required as only about 50% have a lasting complete response and high-dose progesterone alone is not the standard of treatment for endometrial cancer. Ideally, the patient should have a grade 1 endometrioid adenocarcinoma with superficial or no myometrial invasion and no extrauterine disease or metastatic survey. Endometrial biopsy should be performed after 6 months of high-dose progesterone to assess response. Patients who have responded should go on to assisted reproductive treatments. Once childbearing is complete or if treatment is unsuccessful, total hysterectomy, bilateral salpingo-oophorectomy should be offered to the patient as definitive treatment. Survival is related to stage at presentation of disease, and there is a 50% 5-year survival rate at stage 1 cancer as compared to 10% in stage 4 cancer. Treatment should be individualized in women with recurrence, and modalities include surgery, chemotherapy, radiotherapy, and hormonal therapy. I have now come to the end of my presentation. I would like to thank the Department of ONG from NUH and KK Hospital for their support. Thank you for your attention.